All right, welcome back to the Mad Scientist's Corner. Today we'll make some experiments, let's call them experiments, I don't know, with my latest flyback driver that I built. This is a single MOSFET type, let's call it single MOSFET, but as you can see, let's turn on the lights. Okay. As you can see, there are a bunch of things. It's quite complex, but I don't care because I keep it, so I fix it, etc. And let's see, there are also a bunch of toys I'm gonna show you. The logic flow of the project starts with a variac. Then there are two, not three. This is not used. Two UPS transformers, a 50 amps bridge. This is bought on eBay. This is quite good actually. Some capacitors, salvaged capacitors. Maybe they are not enough, but whatever. Then there's a current meter. Full scale is 15 amps, 15, not 50, as you can see here. And then there's the driver, a flyback. This is a semi-good flyback, pretty decent, from a mid-sized TV. A spark gap with a classic heatsink for target, let's call it so. A needle with an LED, as you can see, and the heatsink is connected in series with another small multimeter with the bottom range of 50 milliamperes. So I wanted to build the best driver I can, and I come up with this. This uses various solutions and systems and circuits that I found online and that I also invented by myself. It's a single MOSFET type. Actually, there are a bunch of things. These are diodes, diode. There's a big transistor here, BJT. Single MOSFET, but you can see there are four MOSFETs, four main MOSFETs here. These are IRF 640, 40M put in parallel make like one, only one IRF P 260. So it's like a single IRF P 260, comparable, pretty comparable. And after having boiled this, I intended to make it audio modulated. I tried with the variable duty cycle of the carrier with the 555, but the results were poor. I knew it. Then I found online a video about this guy, Fabrizio Franzoli, that made another driver way simpler than this. This is quite complex, actually. And he gained pretty good results with audio modulation with a square wave on the reset pin of the 555. I tried that as well in this driver, and that was really good, actually. I forgot to mention that the driver has variable frequency on this potentiometer here, variable duty cycle that is adjustable in this case. It runs at the ideal frequency, apparently seems to be apart some variables. The ideal frequency seems to be like 20 kHz for a really solid power conversion. Frequency 20 kHz, duty cycle 60%. That seems to be the best solution for me. The driver can be audio modulated here on this connector here. So the arc is a singing arc. And I can connect on that socket some toys that I have here. I'll show you also the schematic of every component of every part of the project in a moment in this video. We have an MP3 player with a Schmitt trigger. We have the so-called 16, let's focus a bit nearer part, so-called 16 box sound effects music kit that you can build, that you have to build it. And it emits 16 different sounds, different effects on the arc in this case, but originally it has a small speaker. And we have a circuit from an alarm clock. It emits the classic bing, 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 bing sound, but in this case on the singing arc. I modified it, I've added a pair of components to be connected on the audio port. And we have a Jacob's ladder that is also singing if the arc is continuous, but singing in this case. It's not hard to build, this is kind of simple. It has the so-called Gabriel electrode here with a 10 mega ohms resistor and a small filament light bulb that turns on at 10, 20 milliamperes in series with the input, just to make a bit of show. Around 25 milliamperes of high voltage current on the secondary side. This little multimeter is in series with the heatsink, and around 10-12 amps of drawing current on the low voltage side. Under load, it goes at like 20 volts. My power supply isn't that strong. And in open circuit, it goes at like 25 volts. So when the first strike happens, the voltage on the capacitors is 25 volts, but it goes back to 20 volts under load, sometimes 22. Now I am filming with the lowest exposure possible. Singing Jakob Zlatner. I could also make singing X-rays, but now maybe not a great idea. Anyways, my Geiger is not enabled for hi-fi, so I think I'll skip this. Anyways, there's an X-ray video on my channel if you want to check it out, but I warn you, it's in Italian. Okay, these are 89 frames I've taken from a pile of videos I filmed while the driver was powered with low current, limited current, and there was the alarm clock circuit on the audio port. I thought they were really cool to show, and as you can see there are a bunch of lines on the arc. These lines are audio interruptions exactly at 2048 Hz, because the audio of the alarm clock is also timed by the clock crystal. These were just some frames I picked one by one from the videos, and I thought they were cool, and I wanted to show them to you. Now I want to torture test this flyback here. This is a semi-small flyback with a 30 kV wire. It leaks a bit here. You can see the leaking here. There's a small spark happening here that I covered with the hot glue. And it leaks apparently inside on the bottom high voltage windings. It leaks over the primaries here, and it sparks a bit here. I've covered it with hot glue. Hot glue is a really good insulator for especially DC, because at high frequency you have more troubles trying to insulate the thing. There's a needle on the output, and we'll see now if we can extract the longest spark ever. I doubt, of course, but let's see if it doesn't pop. But I don't care much about this flyback. It's small, it's damaged, so let's torture test it. We are at 10 volts DC of supply voltage from my low current. Let's say low current, it's 5 amps bench power supply. Adjusted at 10 volts, we are at a distance of less than 3 centimeters, 2.5 centimeters, and it strikes at 2.5 centimeters. Yeah, it does. Now it's 18 volts at 5 centimeters. Let's try. Okay, it strikes. Now we are at 22 volts with 6 centimeters of distance. Let's try. Okay, you can hear that it bubbles a bit. That's because this capacitor, this electrolytic capacitor here, stores a charge, and it gives an high current spike that can't be sustained by the 5 amps of the power supply, because it's apparently higher than 5 amps, but the capacitor supplies a spike that can give a shot, and this shot turns into some bubbling of the sound. Now it's 25 volts at 7 centimeters. Let's try if it doesn't pop. Okay, let's check the flyback transformer. No signs of arcing. That's interesting. Okay. Now we are at 28 volts DC with 8 centimeters. Let's measure it. Okay. Let's try. Whoa. Now it's 31 volts DC of supply voltage. Okay. And we are at 9 centimeters. Let's measure it again. Okay, that's reliable. Let's try if something doesn't pop. Okay. Oh. Whoa, ozone. I think we are at limit. Anyways, 9 centimeters. We can try 10 centimeters. Now we are again at 31 volts, but with 10 centimeters. Let's measure it. Yeah, it says 20, but this is chopped. This is a piece of a longer strip. Okay, 10 centimeters. Let's try again at 31 volts. I have my doubts. Nothing. Nothing. Come on. Let's try 32 if it's stable. Nothing. Nothing. All right, 9 centimeters. All right, this is the schematic of the main driver. Wait a second, what the hell is this? Damn punks! Just a moment, please. Okay. This is the schematic of the main driver without the audio toys. It's divided into two sections. One on the mounted on the perf board that is here. And another section mounted dead bug style on the heatsink, that is this one. And there's a 555 classic chip. That's quite good for a flyback driver. I'll discuss the actual functionality of the 555 on another schematic. The output of the 555 is connected on a class B totem pole current buffer. I know what you are thinking, some of you are thinking, I could also use just one transistor, this one, but I wanted to make a full, not full bridge, half bridge driver, because I wanted to play with the driving details of the circuit. This totem pole driver drives the gate of the MOSFET through the Schottky diode, 1 ampere Schottky diode that pulls down the gate of the MOSFET really hard, and 220 ohms resistor that instead turns on the MOSFET a bit slower. This to make the classic rising slowly wave and going down hard system that allows a soft current on the turn on on the turning on of the MOSFET on the drain, and instead an high flyback pulse on the turning off of the MOSFET, That's a classic system. I've used for MOSFETs, for IRF 640. This sucks. 640 MOSFETs for 4 ohm in parallel, instead of this 90 amps MOSFET that I found on LTSpice. And this pulls down the primary. The primary is 10 turns on both my two flybacks, on both flybacks, 10 turns. This gives a really hard drive of the flyback, because you can also try with like 16 turns, maybe sometimes. There's this system here with a resonant capacitor. This system here with the two diodes and the resonant capacitor is featured on the so-called super flyback driver from J. Martis, a maker and a high voltage fan. This system here allows this node to swing both on VCC, the V power, 30 volts, 25 volts, both on VCC and GND. This allows this node here to swing on both sensors. This gives a bit of a bit more of a voltage spike on the flyback pulse, and also allows a bit of a bit less turning down current on the MOSFET. That's a little improvement, but worth it for just two diodes. It's worth it. There's another section I've added. This was my conviction. This section is this one. This is a voltage clamp system. There's a diode. These are like 10 amps diodes, ultra fast diodes. These are not so hard to find. You may find them on old TVs, old CRT TVs. This diode here allows only positive pulses and allows this node to swing down. And after the positive pulse at like 200 volts goes here throughout a dampening 1 ohm resistor, and this charges this capacitor here that also dampens farther the current pulse on the voltage clamp. This capacitor is discharged through this transistor here. It's a BU508A. It's actually this transistor here. I've used this one. This is a horizontal flyback transistor from a CRT TV. There are four zeners of 43 volts each put in series. These 43 volts zeners, if you don't have them, because these are weird, let's say weird zeners, these zeners can be substituted with a single NE2222 transistor, because if you put a voltage from the collector to the emitter, letting the base stay open, it will clamp at 43 volts, because that's the maximum voltage an NE2222 can withstand, can hold. There's also this capacitor here that speeds up the turning on of the base of the transistor, a dampening resistor here, and there's also another feature. There's this blue LED here. This blue LED turns on when the 1 ohm resistor reaches 3 volts, so at 3 amps of current, of peak current on the clamping circuit, at 3 amps on the 1 ohm resistor, there are 3 volts on these nodes, and the blue LED turns on. This resistor here is a 220 ohm resistor used to limit the current on the blue LED to avoid it to pop. And other things, there is a 2020 200 microfarads capacitor that stores a bit of charge. It helps the circuit. This is the secondary. I've just tried to simulate the flyback secondary, but it was hard because there are a bunch of factors to think about. Anyways, the logic section of the circuit, there's the V-stabilized, let's call it so. It's in my case 13.2 volts. There's a 7812 EC, stabilized EC, with a pair of diodes that gives more than 12 volts. Then there is this 10 ohm resistor here that I've added to bypass the 555 oscillator and 100 microfarad capacitor to smooth the 555 section. Other things for now, I've added this zener here, 15 volts zener. This zener is not necessarily useful, but you can add it for safety. Also, because my circuit is divided in this point, so when I disconnect the logic section of the circuit, the MOSFET is still protected by the zener from the soldering iron, etc. This is the main oscillator circuit. It has two potentiometers. This one of 500 ohms. This is for the frequency, and this other one of 10K, that is for the duty cycle. These are both linear potentiometers. The output of the 555 can drive or drives this node here, and this potentiometer can swing on both the output, this potentiometer here. Can swing on both the output of the 555 or another node, this one, that is with some sort of voltage divider, but it's not a voltage divider, it's a mid-voltage movable point. When the 555 is, when the potentiometer is turned toward the output, the frequency is at its maximum. When put toward the voltage divider, the frequency is at minimum. The other potentiometer instead, these are connected the one on the other potentiometer instead can swing on both this diode here that charges the oscillator capacitor. Or the other diode here that instead discharges the oscillator capacitor. So when adjusting this potentiometer, you can adjust or more charging and less discharging, or more discharging and less charging. So the 555 can have a duty cycle of from 1% to 99%, but in my case, with these protection resistors, in my case, it goes from 5% to 95%, something like that. And the frequency, you don't have a much high frequency swing with this circuit I found online. The frequency can swing from like 14 kHz to a maximum of 30 kHz. In this case, the duty cycle is way more adjustable than frequency. This is the corrections circuit. I made a pair of corrections on the 555 because the 555 has some flaws. I've added this zener here, a 9.1 volt zener. This zener avoids the oscillator capacitor to go below one third VCC, If we can make the simulation, okay, let's check the output. As you can see, this is the output, and this is the interrupting square wave from the audio. As you can see, we have three pulses, because there are only three pulses in this case. These three pulses are regular. The first is not longer, and the last is not shorter. But if I take out, for instance, this Zener diode and redo the simulation, as you can see, the first pulse becomes way longer. This is typical of the 555 when it starts or it resumes from reset. The first pulse is longer, and we don't want this because the MOSFET can go in avalanche state, or the primary inductance can saturate. This is not okay. We don't want this, and we can avoid this by putting the Zener in place on this spot, because without the Zener, the capacitor voltage, the oscillator capacitor voltage, can go to zero, and we don't want this, because it has to resume from 0 to 2/3 of VCC, and then to 1/3, 2/3 for the oscillation. This Zener here avoids this, and it can stay at a voltage, the capacitor voltage can stay at a level of slightly less than 1/3. Another correction is this system here with a diode, regular diode, and a resistor. If I take out this diode and redo the simulation, we can see that the last pulse instead is shorter, because it's interrupted by the audio. And we don't want this, because it's some sort of wasted pulse on the flyback. This will not add much in terms of arc power, and we can also instead put this diode and resistor here to make the last pulse regular. Making the last pulse regular, it works regularly on the arc. And it also can add a bit of duty cycle that we really like. This is the schematic. And this is the functionality. This is the Schmitt trigger circuit. It has two sections. You can build only one if you're lucky. A non-inverting section with one comparator, and an inverting section. I built only the non-inverting section, because the cell phone, the smartphone I used, has a non-inverting behavior on the output. So when I make an MP3 play, an MP3 with a duty cycle of 70%, the output will have a duty cycle of 70% and not 30. In fact, my MP3s are modulated with a square wave of 70%, made with Audacity with a bit of tricks. And there's a bad news. Most of the modern devices, like smartphones, cell phones, tablets, have an output frequency of 300 kHz fixed, something like that. And it's modulated in PWM, because you can't tell the difference on the earbuds, but the audio amplifier on the output is way simpler with PWM, and so you can't directly connect an electronic circuit like in the past, but you have to add a network like this one. This network with a resistor of low value, a 100 microhenries inductor, and a capacitor, this network gives out an analog signal, an audio signal, and this signal is cut at 20 kHz. But my audio signals are less in frequency, like 6, 8 kHz maximum. Anyways, this circuit is a Schmitt trigger circuit, and it behaves that when there's no signal, so there's silence, the square wave on the input is not present during mute, during not sound. Anyways, the outputs, both non-inverting and inverting, the outputs are low, so the 555 is in reset state. This is thanks to these two nodes with a voltage divider with three resistors, and these two nodes go in both cases, inverting and non-inverting, one on the inverting input of the op amp and the other on the non-inverting input in both cases. But the input signal, let's revert a bit to things, okay. The input signal instead is placed in one case on the non-inverting section, it's placed on the non-inverting input like this, while on the inverting section, if you want to boil the 1 ohm, you don't have to boil the bot. If you're lucky, your smartphone or device is not inverting on the output, so when you make the 70% duty cycle, you'll have 70% output duty cycle and not 30%. Anyways, we were talking about the other section. The other section instead has the input here that is connected instead on the inverting pin of the comparator. I've used not this model of comparator, I used an LM 3 9, this sucks again. 3, this is a 3, okay. I don't have a mouse carpet. Anyways, this works at like 13.2 volts, like my other circuits. I've also tried to characterize the input poorly, but it worked somehow with some noise source to test the Schmitt trigger functionality, because there's also hysteresis. That's the Schmitt trigger, anyways. And, there are a bunch of corrections in this circuit, and it's not perfect, but it works pretty good. This is the alarm clock circuit. The COB chip, COB board, was taken from a dismissed alarm clock, a small alarm clock, if I remember correctly. The coil and magnet are not present, so these connections here are not used. We have the positive, the buzzer, the GND, and the alarm switch connections. Alright, I fitted a red LED. This red LED blocks the supply voltage at like 1.8 volts, thanks to this dropping resistor here, classic resistor and Zener system. There's also a 1 microfarad capacitor here that acts as a bypass capacitor and stabilizes the circuit. That's good. And the audio system works this way. When the buzzer output is low, because the buzzer output is trying to drive the buzzer originally, this line here is low, and this transistor ABC547 that I added to the circuit is actually off. So this pull-up resistor on the driver, on the flyback driver circuit, is pulling high the 555 reset pin. So the arc is actually on. In case instead this line here is high, because the buzzer output is letting the collector, the open collector output is letting it off, so the buzzer is not driven. This transistor here is turned on by this 1K resistor here, 1K is a bit tight actually, but we don't care because we are at really low voltages. So this resistor is driving the transistor on. The transistor goes on and the output instead goes low, resetting, keeping the 555 in reset state. This is the 16-box sound music kit, whatever, whatnot circuit. I've added a pair of components to adapt it to the flyback driver. There's let's use blue. Okay, there's the a dropping resistor on the input positive line. This resistor lowers the 12 volts, actually 13.2 volts, to a value of 3.9 volts thanks to this zener here. And there's also a bypass capacitor of 10 microfarads. It's a cheap capacitor that I've soldered on the circuit. And there's the audio system that is quite similar to the alarm clock circuit. There's a BC547 transistor, pretty similarly. This resistor that pulls up the transistor to turning it on and turning the reset pin instead off on the 555. And there's this transistor that I've substituted with a smaller transistor because this was some sort of small I current transistor, like a 2222 or S8050. Anyways, I put a BC547 that is cheaper, and I wanted the sub-batch transistor, the new transistor. The speaker is not present, and that's it. Anyways, this circuit is divided originally in two sections. The first section is with these switches here and these logic ports here. This section decides the type of sound. There are four types of sounds with the KD9561, and another section is instead this one here. If I can make a good job. Okay, bingo. This section here instead decides the oscillating frequency of the KD9561, so it varies the actual speed of the entire system and the speed of the sound and frequency of the sound, etc. Thank you for having watched my entire video. I suppose you have watched the entire video. I don't know. I hope. I really hope, because YouTube is angry toward me. Anyways, we'll see in the future. They say so. You know, the future, the thing that is after the present, that thing,